بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، just a quick reminder before we are khatira today. We finished 1/3 of the month of Ramadan. 10 of the days of fasting have gone by, and we have only 2/3 of the month left. And it is around this time that our nafs begins to get tired, that many of us, we really kind of lose our concentration, we lose our perpetuity of ibadah. Many of us, we're not able to continue the qiyam, or we cut back on the Quran. And the fact of the matter is, these middle 10 are usually the most toughest, because the last 10, we re-energize, we reinvigorate for the last 10. So these middle 10 is the dip that we go down. And we have to remind ourselves that, as our Prophet ﷺ said, the most beloved of all deeds to Allah is that which is consistent. إِنَّ أَحَبَّ الْأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَدْوَمُهَا وَإِنْ قَلْ. Even if it's something that is small, but it is consistent. So I remind myself and all of you to not give up now, to not become slack and lazy now. Alhamdulillah, we've been going strong for 10 days. We have another 10 before the final 10 of Ramadan, and then that is it, Ramadan is over. Just a quick khatir about today's qira'ah, today's recitation. We did Surah Tawbah, we're doing Surah Tawbah today. And Surah Tawbah, there's so much to talk about. I'll concentrate on one verse. And it is the verse that we shall recite, inshallah, in either the fifth or the sixth raka'ah. And it deals with the story of Ka'b ibn Malik. The story of Ka'b ibn Malik is a very long and a very beautiful story. And I'll summarize it. Ka'b ibn Malik was one of the famous Ansar. He was of the Ansar. And in the battle of Tabuk, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a general announcement that everybody has to go for this battle of Tabuk. And it was going to be one of the most difficult battles of the Muslims. Why? For three reasons. Number one, because it was in July. So you're going to have to travel in July. And we think Memphis is hot in July. Try living in Medina in July. Number two, it was right before the season to harvest the dates. So if they went for Tabuk, they would not be able to prepare the plantation to get the dates. So their harvest for that year would be severely diminished. And their harvest was their annual income. They didn't get a monthly paycheck like we do. Their annual income was their harvest. So if they went for Tabuk, it would have been a severe financial loss for them. And number three, the third reason why Tabuk was one of the most difficult was because the perception was the Muslims would be fighting against the Romans. The Muslims would be fighting against the Romans. Tabuk is northern Arabia. And the Prophet ﷺ, because it was so difficult, he announced the plans publicly. Otherwise, for other plans that he did, he never announced publicly. Even when he went to conquer Mecca, he didn't tell the people, I'm going to conquer Mecca, because he wanted to surprise. But Tabuk, because it was so difficult, he publicly announced, we're going to Tabuk. I need you to prepare a long, difficult journey. And he said, every able-bodied male must come. No staying behind. There's mandatory drafting for all of the Sahaba who have physically able to go. Now, Ka'b ibn Malik said that I was completely physically fit. And I had two camels, not just one, two camels. And I was never in such good health as I was that year. But as the battle plans and as the Prophet ﷺ would send messengers, come get ready and everybody prepare, I kept on hearing, I said to myself, I'm a young man. It'll take me half an hour to pack my saddle, jump into my camel and go. I don't need to prepare. I don't need to do anything. So I kept on delaying until finally the crier said, there's one day left. And I said, Yalla, Bismillah, tomorrow morning I'll get ready and I'll go. And when the Prophet ﷺ began to leave Medina, Shaitan again whispered to him and said, you know what? You have a fast camel. You can catch them up. Don't worry. Right? Until finally it struck me that it was too late. That the caravan had indeed left. And I could not catch up to them. And Ka'b ibn Malik said that it depressed me greatly that when I looked around Medina, all I could see were the lame, the blind, the poor, the beggars, and the hypocrites. Every single able-bodied Muslim that I know was all gone. I only saw women, children, and the lame and the blind, crutches. Everybody had gone. And I began to wonder, what have I done to myself? What will I tell the Prophet ﷺ when he comes back? And in fact, the Prophet ﷺ asked about Ka'b. When the army was on its way to Tabuk, he said, where is Ka'b? Ka'b is one of our people. He's the Ansari. He's not one of the hypocrites. Where is Ka'b? And he was monitoring. And Ka'b was nowhere to be seen because he had remained behind in Medina. And so he started thinking to himself. The Prophet was gone for almost a month and a half. And during this time he's thinking, what excuse can I say to the Prophet to have him forgive me? Until finally the news came that the Prophet had returned to Medina. And the first thing that he did, it was his sunnah. When he came back to the city, he would go to the masjid. He wouldn't go home immediately, he would pray two rak'at in the masjid. And then he would sit in the masjid, accepting the visitors who came from Medina, accepting the local excuses. And one by one a long line was formed for those who didn't go to Tabuk. Now, it was the qadr of Allah that when the army heard the Muslims arrived at Tabuk, when the Romans and the Ghassanids heard that the Prophet was there, they were too scared to show up. So there never actually was a battle. And this is the wisdom of Allah. Allah tested them without actually testing them. Allah tested them by bringing them all the way to Tabuk. Once they got there, alhamdulillah, there was no fighting. So it was a test from Allah to see who would follow, right? So Ka'b was of those who remained behind. The Prophet returned. There's never actually now been a battle. He returned safe and sound. And a long line forms of hypocrites. Every one of them. And in this line as well are the lame and the crippled and the blind. Because they have to make an excuse. Why didn't they come? And of course, the Quran says the lame and the crippled, the blind, لَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٌ وَلَى الْعَرَجِ حَرَجٌ وَلَى الْمَرِيضِ حَرَجٌ, right? The Quran clearly says there's no problem in you. So their excuse is accepted. The hypocrites, every one of them began thinking of some elaborate excuse. Oh, I had a severe fever that day when you left. Oh, this, oh, that. I had to take care of my elderly mother. They're just inventing, fabricating excuses. And the Prophet ﷺ would simply smile and say, accept that excuse. In his mercy, in his rahmah, he didn't bother to verify. It just khalas, between you and Allah. Allah knows whether you're lying or telling me the truth. Ka'b said, I waited my turn in line, dreading, the fears building, until finally I sat in front of the Prophet ﷺ and I saw him smile at me, the smile of an angry person. The Prophet ﷺ was angry at him because Ka'b is not the hypocrite. And he said to Ka'b, what is your excuse, O Ka'b? And right then and there, Ka'b, his iman came rushing back to him. And he said, Ya Rasulallah, Wallahi, I am one of the best manipulators amongst my people. And if I were sitting in front of anybody else, I would have weaseled my way out of my predicament. I would have invented an excuse that would have pleased anybody except you, Ya Rasulallah. Because if I lie to you, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will expose me from above the seven heavens. I can't fool you. I cannot trick you. And so, Ya Rasulullah, I have no excuse. For by Allah, I was never healthier than I was in the battle of Tabuk. And I never had more money. And in fact, he even said, I had two camels. And never was I better prepared to help you than the battle of Tabuk. But my soul got the better of me. It just got too difficult. And by the way, this shows us the dangers of procrastination. The dangers of delaying. Inshallah tomorrow, inshallah tomorrow, inshallah tomorrow. Because that's what happened with Ka'b. Every time a messenger would come, I'm ready, I'm prepared, I can do it. And this is one of the plots of shaitan, is to make you procrastinate. And in this, Ka'b fell. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, I have no excuse. When the Ka'b said this, the Prophet ﷺ said, as for Ka'b, then he has told the truth. He didn't say this to any of the hypocrites before. He's saying, okay, bismillah, whatever Allah wills, fine. But when Ka'b said this, he said, as for Ka'b, he has spoken the truth. Go back, Ka'b, to your family and wait until Allah decides your fate. You have committed a sin because I commanded you to come. You disobeyed me. This is a sin. So go back and wait until Allah decides your fate. So Ka'b says, I went back depressed and sad. And as I walked out of the masjid, my tribesmen surrounded me and said, why were you so foolish? Why did you have to embarrass yourself? And they gave a long list of all the hypocrites. So-and-so said this, so-and-so said that. Why couldn't you invent an excuse? Surely you are better qualified than they are to invent an excuse. Did you have to embarrass us and our tribe and yourself by being honest? And so Ka'b said, I almost was going to go back and think of an excuse until I asked them, did anybody else say what I said, that I'm guilty? Did anybody be honest to the Prophet and say, yes, I'm guilty as charged? And they said, yes. And they mentioned two of the noble of the Sahaba. Two of the Sahaba that they knew to be righteous men. Ka'ab said, when I heard those two names compared to the list of hypocrites, I knew I was in the right company. When those two names came, that yes, they said the exact same thing as you, we're guilty, Ya Rasulullah, we don't have an excuse. Ka'ab said, I knew I was in the right company. And this shows us, brothers and sisters, that the mu'min cares about quality and not quantity. The mu'min cares about who he's hanging around. The mu'min wants to be in the company of the righteous. And so Ka'ab went back. And the news came to him that the Prophet ﷺ had issued a commandment that these three people should be boycotted by the Muslims. No one should speak to them. Ignore them as if they didn't exist. Not even return the salams. And Ka'b ibn Malik said, this happened for 40 days. Ka'b ibn Malik said, these 40 days were the worst days of my life. I would wander in the city and it was as if I was a ghost. Nobody looked at me. Nobody returned my salam. It was as if I didn't exist. I came to the masjid and people are not completely ignoring me. I would even go to the Prophet ﷺ and say, Assalamu alaikum, hoping that his lips might move. And I wasn't sure even whether his lips moved or not. Because the command came down to Allah, their punishment is boycott, complete isolation for the time being, until Allah decides their fate. And after 30 days, Ka'ab said, I became so asphyxiated, so worried that I had a cousin, my best friend, that he grew up with, right? He was his best friend, his neighbor, his cousin. He was my bosom buddy. And it hurt me, it grieved me so much that I went to his house and I just came into his house and I said, Oh my dear cousin, surely you know that I'm not a hypocrite. Now the cousin has been told, don't say anything. And so he ignored his own cousin, the one he grew up with. He's ignoring Ka'ab, right? And Ka'ab begins to cry because it's too much for him that everybody's boycotting him. And he says, surely you know that I am not a hypocrite. And after a while, the cousin just mumbles into the air, Allah and His Messenger knows best. And that was what killed Ka'ab. Allah and His Messenger knows best. I don't know. Allah and His Messenger knows best. And then after 40 days, the commandment came that the Prophet ﷺ is telling the wives of these three men to go back to their families for the time being. That not even with the wives they can be together. And one of the tribesmen of Ka'ab came and told him that, oh Ka'ab, one of these three is an elderly man. He asked, his wife came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, Ya Rasulullah, my husband, you know his state. He is too old to actually have any physical relation with me. But he's an elderly man and he needs someone to take care of him. Do you allow me to take care of him without being physical? Because he has no need for this anyway. And by Allah, she said, by Allah, since your commandment came, he has been doing nothing except crying in the corner of the house for the last 40 days. So the Prophet ﷺ allowed the wife to take care and feed and whatnot and just avoid physical contact. So Ka'ab's relatives came and said, why don't you ask the Prophet ﷺ for the same concession? Ka'ab said, what excuse do I have? He is an elderly man. I'm in my young prime. What excuse do I have? And so his wife as well goes to her own family. And for a further 10 days, complete isolation. During these days, Ka'ab said, I went to the marketplace as if the world, he said in the hadith, the world became a different world for me. This was not the world I knew, right? The world became a different world for me. And as I was wandering in the marketplace, there was a Christian Arab from the tribe of Ghassan, was in Medina for buying and selling. And he says, where is Ka'ab ibn Malik? Where is Ka'ab ibn Malik? And so the people, they just pointed in my direction. And so the man came to me and thrust a letter in my hand. I opened it up and it said, from the king of the Ghassanids. This is the people whom the Prophet went to fight in Tabuk. From the king of the Ghassanids to Ka'ab ibn Malik. It has reached us that your friend, i.e. the Prophet ﷺ, has shown you a harshness. And someone as noble as you, the chieftain, the noble tribeman that you are, you don't deserve this type of treatment. Come to us and we shall honor you like you have never been honored before. Money, wealth, fame, power, come to us, the king is saying. Come to us, we will honor you like we've never been honored before. Ka'ab said, immediately I knew this was another test from Allah. This was another test from Allah. So I tore the letter up and threw it into the oven to burn away. And as I was sitting there one morning after Salat al-Fajr, crying and he prayed on his roof because he was just so lonely, so praying on his roof, crying. When I heard a crier coming from the Prophet ﷺ masjid, crying out, Ya Ka'b ibn Malik, good news, abshir, Ya Ka'b ibn Malik, abshir. And Ka'b ibn Malik, as soon as he heard that, he fell into sajda, because there's only one good news that can happen now. Fell into sajda and thanked Allah Azza wa Jal, because Allah had just revealed the verse we're going to recite in the fourth or fifth or sixth rak'ah. وَعَلَى الثَّلَاثَةِ الَّذِينَ خُلِّفُوا. And regarding those three who remained behind, this is in the Quran, Surah Tawbah. Regarding those three who remained behind, وَعَلَى الثَّلَاثَةِ الَّذِينَ خُلِّفُوا. حَتَّى إِذَا ضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَرْضُ بِمَا رَحُبَتْ. Until the world became constricted, even though it was so vast. وَضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ أَنفُسُهُمْ. And their bodies became constricted. وَظَنُّوا أَلَّا مَلْجَأَ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ. And they realized that there is no escaping from Allah except to Allah. Beautiful verse. You cannot run away from Allah except to Allah. No one can protect you against Allah other than Allah. And so Allah says they realize that there is no running away from Allah except to Allah. Allah says that their repentance has been accepted. So Ka'ab was so happy that this messenger had come running to him that he gifted him the cloth on his back. And he said, this is all that I have now. And he had no other garment in the house. He's so happy, he's all the only possession, all of his possessions now, he's given for the 50 days that he's been there, he feels so guilty, he's given all of it. He doesn't own anything. All of the gardens he had, all of the camels, all gone now. Khalas. So he only had the clothes on his back. So when the messenger came, he literally gifted his garment and he was left naked and in his house. He had to call out to his neighbor, can I borrow your thobe to go to the Prophet ﷺ? So the neighbor threw him a thobe and he came rushing to the Prophet ﷺ, rushing to the masjid. He goes, wherever I went, people were beaming and smiling, congratulating me. And when I came to the masjid, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh and others of the Sahaba, they stood up to greet me and hugged me. And when I came to the Prophet ﷺ was smiling. And he said, and when he smiled, it was as if it was the full moon on his face. It was as if the moon was on his face. He was smiling. He's so happy for Ka'b's sake. He's happy for Ka'b. He's not gaining anything, but it is his ummah. And he said, Abshir ya Ka'b, that be grateful, O Ka'b, for the best day that you have ever seen since your mother gave birth to you. That Allah has revealed in the Quran that your tawbah has been accepted. That Allah has revealed in the Quran that your tawbah has been accepted. And so Ka'b said, O Messenger of Allah, O Messenger of Allah, Allah knows that the only reason that I am sitting here today is because of my honesty. And so I make a promise to you, O Messenger of Allah, that as long as I live, I shall never ever speak a lie, even if it means it will be harmful to me. Because this is the only thing that has saved me today. That I didn't lie like the hypocrites. And I told you honestly that I am sinful. And Ka'b said that I don't know of anybody who was tested more with telling the truth than me. That throughout my life, always I had to face situations where the truth was bitter, but I fulfilled my promise of always telling the truth. This is in a nutshell the story of Ka'b ibn Malik, and what we learn from it is many things. First and foremost, that Allah's tawbah is so infinite and vast that even someone who disobeys the direct command of the Prophet ﷺ, Allah Azza wa Jal can forgive him. And Allah Azza wa Jal, this whole surah is full of tawbah. It's called Surah At-Tawbah, right? We just recited At-Ta'ibun Al-Abidun Al-Hamidun, those who repent to Allah. We just recited right now in the fourth rak'ah, Allah Azza wa Jal says that there are those who اختلطوا عملا صالحا وآخر عملا سيئا وآخر. No, اختلطوا, what is it? خلطوا عملا صالحا وآخر سيئا. That there are those who have mixed between good and bad. عسى الله أن يتوب عليهم. Perhaps Allah will forgive them. Though there are those Muslims who have mixed between a lot of good and a lot of bad, perhaps Allah will forgive them. Ibn Abbas said, every time Allah says perhaps, He will do it. Every time there is an asa, Allah will do it. Because there is no perhaps in Allah's eyes. That Allah can do it. And so anybody who's mixed between good and bad and repents to Allah, as the story of Ka'b shows, Allah Azza wa Jal will forgive him. And one of the most important things that we learn, brothers and sisters, is exactly as what Ka'b said. That what saves a person is honesty. What saves a person is honesty. Many of us, when we're caught in a situation, We just think, let me just white lie, quick lie, get out of it. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, I know and you know, that one lie leads to a bigger one, and then a bigger, and then a bigger. This is what we experience. That telling lies, hiding our own faults, trying to ignore them, doesn't make them go away. And being honest with yourself, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being sincere in front of Allah. And Allah says in the Quran, that O you who believe, speak the truth, even if it is against yourselves. Even وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوِ الْوَالِدَيْنِ or your own parents. The rights of the parents do not transgress, do not transcend the rights of telling the truth. Speaking the truth is more important even than your own honesty, integrity, your own ego, and that of your parents. وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوِ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ Allah Azza wa Jal has commanded us to be truthful to Him, to be truthful to His religion, to be truthful to all of the Muslims. And therefore the primary benefit that we learn from the story of Ka'b is honesty is what saves. Next time, brothers and sisters, we find ourselves in a predicament and we think that one quick lie will get us out of it. Be honest with yourself and remind yourself of this story of Ka'b ibn Malik, that Allah Azza wa Jal saved him because he was truthful to Allah, because he knew he couldn't fool Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he realized saying, I'm sorry, I made a mistake, was the best way to show that he was sincere and true and honest. Every one of us makes mistakes, every one of us. None of us is perfect. And the best way to show that you're as close to perfection as possible is to admit that you made a mistake. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who benefit from this beautiful story and Surah At-Tawbah. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'een.